Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. This is a description of the male genital system data show. This is a diagram demonstrating the testis structure. Here we have at the outermost part, we have this pouch called tunica vaginalis. It is formed of a visceral layer applied over the tunica albuginea and a parietal layer. And in between, we have this thin space filled with a serous fluid to help the act as a lubricant, allowing the free movement of the testes. Then we have the tunica albuginea, here, this area. Tunica albuginea is called by this name because albo means white, and it is white in color because it is formed of dense white fibrous connective tissue. It is thickened posteriorly to form the mediastinum testis, and from which we have trabeculae that arise, dividing the testis into various compartments. Each compartment contains from 1 to 4 seminiferous tubules. The innermost layer, actually, which lines the tunica albuginea, is a layer, very thin layer, rich in blood vessels called tunica vasculosa, and also it covers the trabeculae. After that, we have the seminiferous tubules, and these seminiferous tubules will pour their secretion of cells inside this part, which is called reed testis. Reed means a shabaka, network. So it is a network at the mediastinum testis, or the posterior part of the testis. Then from this network, the sperms will pass through the vasa efferentia. Then the epididymis. Epi means above, didymis means testis. And then it will enter the body cavity through the vas deferens. In this picture, you will notice that this is a section in the testis in a low power. And we have here the second fibrous connective tissue, white fibrous connective tissue, which is the tunica albuginea. And here you can see various lobules in the testis, of course, separated by the trabeculae arising from reed testis, or arising from that mediastinum testis, which is this area, mediastinum with the reed testis. Here we have the seminiferous tubules that will deliver their production of the sperms to the reed testis, to the reedy testis, and will pass to the outside through the vasa efferentia. On the surface of the testis, you have sections in the epididymis tubules, and of course, these are blood vessels. Again, this is a higher magnification for that section in the testis. You can diagnose here the tunica albuginea formed of the collagen fibers. And here it is the cavity of the tunica vaginalis, layer, visceral layer covering the tunica albuginea, and a parietal layer. Both are formed of simple squamous, and this is a cavity containing the serous fluid that helps the lubrication during movement of the testis. Here we have the seminiferous tubules, as you see, and this is the lining cells, which are the spermatogenic cells with the Sertoli cells. In between, we have the interstitial tissue that contains the interstitial cells of Leydig, as well as fenestrated blood capillaries. Here is a picture showing the interstitial cells of Leydig, as well as parts of the two seminiferous tubules. We'll start by the seminiferous tubule. You will see these oval nuclei or flat nuclei. They are belonging to the myoid cells. These myoid cells are flattened contractile cells, and their contraction helps the propulsion of the spermatozoa towards the reedy testis. Also, we have this basement membrane. So we have the myoid cells and then the basement membrane. Here, these are the myoid cells, and then we have this basement membrane. On the basement membrane, you will first see the spermatogonia. The spermatogonia here have a diameter of 12 micrometer in diameter. So here we have a diameter of 12 micrometer in diameter. And these cells actually are of two types. We have dark type A and pale type A, and a third type, which is the type B. Here we have also the nuclei of the Sertoli cells. Here the Sertoli cells actually has L-defined boundaries, so that you cannot see the sidewalls of these cells clearly in the light microscope, but you diagnose them by the nuclei, which are large, pale, with a pale acidophilic cytoplasm, and the nuclei are very near to the basement membrane. But the cell actually extends from the basement membrane till the lumen of the seminiferous tubule. Here, you may be asked about the criteria of the Sertoli cells and the functions of the Sertoli cells. That will be summarized in a later stage. Here also we have this large cell, or even the largest cell, which is the primary spermatocytes. These primary spermatocytes are characterized by having this large nucleus. Of course, it is a diploid nucleus, but showing the chromosomes in various stages of coiling, giving this very specific, peculiar appearance for the primary spermatocytes. And actually, they spend about 22 days in the prophase of this first meiotic division. So the majority of the primary spermatocytes are seen in the sections at this stage, which is the prophase of the first meiotic division. Then we have, of course, we will have the secondary spermatocytes, which are much smaller and having haploid number, but they are difficult to be observed as they are short-lived and pass very rapidly and complete very rapidly the second meiotic division to give rise to the spermatids, which are small and with central rounded, here it appears rounded, dark nucleus, and they are the most near to the lumen. The spermatogenic cells are spermatogonia, 12 micrometer in diameter, has three types, dark A with a dark ovoid nucleus, and they are called precursor cells, or considered as precursor cells. Pale A, or cycling cells, with a pale ovoid nucleus, and type E, with a pale, more spherical nucleus. This type undergo mitosis and enlarge in size, performing gross to form the primary spermatocytes, 18 micrometer in diameter, the largest with the largest nucleus, and it has a characteristic shape for the appearance of the chromosomes in different stages of coiling, and they contain a diploid number of chromosomes. They start the first meiotic division and remain in the prophase of the first meiotic division for about 22 days. So the majority of the primary spermatocytes are seen in this stage in the section. After they complete the primary or the first meiotic division, they are now called secondary spermatocytes. They are smaller, difficult to be seen, as they are rapidly enter and complete the second meiotic division to form the spermatid. These cells have a haploid number of chromosomes in the D form, D chromosomes. Then we have the spermatids, which are 7 to 8 micrometer, and they undergo spermiogenesis to form spermatocytes. They are having central rounded dark nucleus. They have a dark nucleus. This is a picture for the seminiferous tubule. These are the myoid cells. These are blood vessels in the interstitial tissue, lined by the flat endothelial cells, and these are the interstitial cells of Leydig. Here we have a pale large nucleus with prominent nucleolus, it is of Sertoli cell. Here we have rounded cell with a dark, relatively dark nucleus. This is a spermatogonium. Here we have a very large cell with characteristic appearance of coiling of chromosomes. These are the primary spermatocytes. This diagram to help you to study the light microscope picture and the electron microscope picture of the Sertoli cells. Sertoli cells have ill-defined boundaries, has a pale acidophilic cytoplasm, and a pale nucleus, which is oval or triangular with prominent nucleolus, and it is resting on the base membrane at east, and it reaches the lumen of the seminiferous tubule. By the electron microscope, we have 10 characters. It is rich in Golgi apparatus, mitochondria, rough ER, smooth ER, free ribosomes, lipid droplets, lysosomes, microtubules, microfilaments, and don't forget that they have tight junctions at the cytoplasmic extensions in the basal part to form the blood testis barrier. So we have 10, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. This picture to help you to study the functions of the Sertoli. Number one, the support and the nourishment of the spermatogenic cells. Number two, secretion of three things. Number one, testicular fluid rich in fructose, androgen binding protein, and inhibin hormone. Number three, phagocytosis of residual bodies and degenerating cells. Number four, which is very important, formation of the blood testis barrier. This function actually is very important, as it is important in selection of the materials, the good nutritive materials to pass to the spermatogenic cells. Number two, isolation of the harmful material. Number three, providing special environment for the spermatogenic cells, which is rich in sodium, potassium, androgen binding hormone, protein. And finally, the prevention of autoimmune, as the spermatogenic cells will produce the sperms after puberty, so the immune system does not know these cells, so produces antibodies against these cells. These antibodies are prevented from reaching the spermatogenic cells by the blood testis barrier. This is a diagram showing the structure of the seminiferous tubule. As you see, we have here the basement membrane, the myoid cells, blood capillaries, the interstitial cells producing the testosterone, blood capillaries lined by flat endothelial cells. Also, we have prominent fibroblasts, as we have said, in this connective tissue. Then we have here the Sertoli cell. Sertoli cell, you cannot see the boundaries of this cell. You can diagnose only the pale nucleus with prominent nucleolus very near to the base membrane. But here we have this well-demarked cell boundary with this nucleus that may be dark or pale, and it is resting on the base membrane. Then we have the primary spermatocyte with a diploid number, and after finishing the first meiotic, it forms the secondary spermatocyte that will complete the second meiotic to form the spermatids. By spermiogenesis, they will form the spermatozoon or the sperms. Again, these are the interstitial cells, blood capillary. The interstitial cells produce the testosterone, and this the blood capillary will take this secretion. Here we have the seminiferous tubules, 1, 2, 3, 4. And here we have, these are myoid cells. This is the spermatogonium. This is the primary spermatocyte. These are the spermatids. This is the nucleus of Sertoli. This is a section in the testis showing seminiferous tubules together with interstitial tissue. Here we have the interstitial tissue of Leydig, and it is showing this polygonal shape and the vacuolated cytoplasm, the pale nucleus with prominent nucleus. These are the myoid cells. This is the basement membrane, and this is a pale nucleus resting on the base. So this is of Sertoli cell. And this is a dark nucleus, so this is of spermatogonium. And this is a large cell with a large nucleus with characteristic appearance of coiling of chromosomes. This is the primary spermatocytes. And these are rounded cells with a dark nucleus. This is the spermatid. This is a picture for the seminiferous tubules with the interstitial tissue. Here you can see the interstitial cell of Leydig, and it is characterized by having this achromatic nucleus or pale vesicular nucleus with prominent nucleolus. And the shape is polygonal, متعددة الأسطح, and it is characterized by having acidophilic cytoplasm. In the interstitial tissue also, you can see these cells, which are fibroblasts. They are present in huge number. What else, as regards the cells, we have also a macrophage, mast cell, and undifferentiated mesenchymal cell. Here you will see the seminiferous tubule and the myoid cells. All these cells that have a shape or an outline, these are spermatogonia at different stages of activity. We have dark, we have pale, and these cells here are the primary spermatocytes characterized by the appearance of the coiling of the chromosomes, very evident here, and they are in the prophase of the first meiotic division. This picture to demonstrate the interstitial cells. Interstitial cells, as we have said, polygonal, and they are characterized by having a pale nucleus with one or two nucleoli, and they are rich in the lipid droplets. Here the lipid droplets are very evident in these interstitial cells. Of course, you can see, as I have said, we have many fibroblasts in this interstitial tissue. All of these with lipid droplets are the interstitial cells that produce the testosterone. If you are asked about the expected EM picture, it is characterized by having a lot of smooth endoplasmic reticulum, mitochondria, and lipid droplets as they secrete the testosterone. Of course, you can see here also the myoid cells, and in addition to the interstitial, we have also this loose connective tissue. Again, here we have the myoid cells, the basement membrane, these cells which can see the boundaries of it, they are the spermatogonia in different stages of activity. And then we have these larger cells with a larger nucleus. This is the primary spermatocyte. And then we have these cells here. They are the spermatids that by spermiogenesis will form the spermatozoa. Also, notice this pale nucleus with no evident boundaries. This is the nucleus of the Sertoli, and this is the nucleolus. So this is a Sertoli, spermatogonia, primary spermatocytes, spermatids, myoid cells, interstitial cells. After the production of the sperms, here in the seminiferous tubules, the sperms will pass to the reti testis, reti meaning reticulum, which is present in the mediastinum testis, and then will pass to the vasa efferentia, that will collect to the in the epididymis, and then pass through the vas deferens. This is a section in the epididymis, and we all know that the epididymis is a highly convoluted tubule. By cutting a section, you will see the sections in different sections in the same tubule. The diameter of the tubule is from 400 to 500 micrometer. Here we have the lining epithelium of this tubule. It is pseudostratified, columnar, ciliated with stereocilia. These projections are actually not cilia, they are stereocilia, as they are microvilli without any microtubule, so they are called stereocilia. And they have gism cilia, but they are not true cilia. Surrounding this epithelium, we have a thin layer of connective tissue together with smooth muscle for the propulsion of the contents in the epididymis. Again, this is a section in the epididymis showing the tubule of the epididymis lined by pseudostratified, columnar, ciliated with stereocilia, and these are the sperms inside. And this is the connective tissue surrounding the tubule, and most important is the smooth muscle layer here surrounding the epididymis tubule. These are typical smooth muscle and not like the myoid cells present around the seminiferous tubule. What are the functions of the epididymis? Epididymis is responsible for the following functions. Number one, the storage of the sperms. Number two, secretion of glycoproteins. Which has an important role in maturation of the spermatozoa. Number three, absorption. Absorption of the remaining testicular fluid. Number four, phagocytosis of the residual bodies and degenerated spermatozoa, exactly like the Sertoli cell function. Number five, it is the propelling propelling of the spermatozoa to the vas deferens by the peristaltic contraction of the surrounding smooth muscle. So from this function you can expect what are the important or the numerous well-developed organelles in the cells of the epididymis. We can expect that they have a lot of Golgi apparatus, rough endoplasmic reticulum, as they produce glycoprotein. We also can expect they have a lot of lysosomes as they are responsible for phagocytosis. This is a section in the vas deferens. And as you see, this is the lumen of the vas deferens, and the muscle layer is very thick, meaning making the most of the thickness of the wall, formed of three layers, inner and outer longitudinal, and in between we have circularly arranged smooth muscle fibers, like the arrangement in the urinary bladder. We have inner and outer longitudinal, and in between we have circular. The function of the vas deferens is propelling the spermatozoa towards the ejaculatory duct and urethra during the ejaculation. Here it is more details of the structure of the wall of the vas deferens. We have here the lining epithelium of the mucosa, which is pseudostratified, columnar, ciliated with non-motile cilia or stereocilia in the lower part, but in the upper part, these cilia will be disappear. Here, this epithelium, it should rest on a very narrow layer of connective tissue. This just light area you see, and after that you will see the muscle layer formed of three bundles, this one, and this, and this. We have inner and outer longitudinal, and between we have the circle. And on the outermost, we have the adventitial. This is a diagram for the spermatic cord. It includes the following. It includes most important structure here will be the vas deferens. This is the mucosa formed of epithelium, thin layer of connective tissue, and the musculosa, three layers, and the connective tissue adventitia. In addition to that, you will see a pampiniform plexus of veins here lined by endothelial cells and containing blood. Also, you will see an artery with thick wall narolumen, which is the cremasteric artery. In addition to an important also structure is the cremasteric muscle, which is a skeletal muscle with a peripheral nucleus, but it is involuntary. Of course, you can expect to find sections in nerves in this connective tissue, gathering all this structure together. Now, this is the actual section of the spermatic cord. The most important feature is the vas deferens, and this is the lining epithelium pseudostratified columnar, and the thick muscle layer formed of three bundles and adventitia. And here we have the cremasteric muscle, which is a skeletal muscle. And here we have the pampiniform plexus of veins, and we have here the testicular artery. This is the section in the prostate. You can see now it has a thick capsule. It has well-developed septa or trabeculae dividing the prostate into lobes. And in the center, you can see this urethra, which is the prostatic urethra. Also, in this section, we can see sections in the ejaculatory ducts as they approach the prostatic urethra. In this picture, you can see that the acini are divided into mucosal, which are very near to the urethra, submucosal and peripheral, or the main group, the peripheral or the main group. So we have mucosal, submucosal, and peripheral. In this picture, you will notice the thick trabeculae. Here, the trabeculae are very thick, full of the collagen fibers, together with the smooth muscle. So it is called fibromuscular trabeculae, and the same is for the capsule. So the stroma is characterized by being fibrovascular in the prostatic gland. As regards the acini, which represent the parenchyma of the gland, these acini are tubulo-alveolar glands. Of course, compound tubulo-alveolar. Here, the acini actually are in large number, from 30 to 50, and they are present in concentric groups. But you cannot see the groups here in this picture. If you are asked what is the lining epithelium of these acini, it is pseudostratified columnar to columnar epithelium. Yani maybe simple columnar or pseudostratified columnar. And of course, resting on a basement membrane. And outside this membrane, we have a lamina propria of connective tissue, but not evident in this picture. Here you can see more details of the prostatic acinus. It is lined by pseudostratified columnar in this picture, and it may be lined also by simple columnar. Outside we have a very thin layer of connective tissue, and this is the fibromuscular stroma. Here we have acidophilic bodies present inside. These are called as prostatic concretion. Concrete means a cement, so they are called prostatic concretion as they are calcified. And also they have another name, corpora amelinchia. They increase in case of old age. Notice that the wall of the acinus is highly folded, and this is very characteristic for the prostatic acini. The fold of the wall, together with the corpora amelinchia and the fibromuscular stroma. If you are asked what is the EM picture of the cells lining the acini, it is the feature of protein synthesizing cells. So we have rough endoplasmic reticulum, Golgi apparatus, and secretory granules. يبقى number 3 secretory granules. طيب why they have well developed apparatus for protein synthesis, this is related to the function. So what is the function of the prostate? The function of the prostate is the production of a secretion that is thin and milky, and it has a characteristic odor. This secretion is rich in number one, acid phosphatase. It is an enzyme, so it is protein in nature. Amylase is also an enzyme, so it is protein in nature. And also fibrinolysin, also it's a protein. Fibrinolysin is responsible for the liquefaction of the coagulated semen after its deposition in the female vagina, so to allow the free movement of the sperms towards the uterus. So these are the functions of the prostate. The secretion of the prostate is thin and milky with a characteristic odor, and it contains these three protein materials which are very important. Here again we have these prostatic concretions or corpora amylacea, acidophilic masses which are calcified inside the prostatic acini, and they increase with the advance of age. Notice the wall of the acinus is highly folded, and this is the fibromuscular stroma of the prostate. This is the picture for a diagram in the section in the penis. You observe that it is covered by the skin, but this skin is devoid of fat, like that of the eyelid. Also, you can see that it has three corpora, two corpora cavernosa and corpus spongiosum. The corpora cavernosa are surrounded by the thick tunica albuginea, while the corpus spongiosum is surrounded by a thinner tunica albuginea. Here the corpora cavernosa contain the these cavernous spaces, blood spaces, and in the center of each we have a deep artery. The corpus spongiosum also contains the cavernous blood spaces, and in the center we have the penile urethra. Here, notice that we have many vessels in this structure. We have dorsal arteries, two, and deep arteries. We have dorsal and deep. These are the dorsal arteries, these are the deep arteries. Also, we have a superficial dorsal vein and deep dorsal vein. Superficial and deep dorsal veins, and here we have dorsal arteries and deep arteries. This is also a diagram for the transverse section in the penis. This represents the skin, and this is the superficial and deep dorsal veins. We have dorsal veins. Here we have two dorsal arteries and two deep arteries. This is the tunica albuginea, which is thicker in case of the corpora cavernosa. These are the cavernous blood spaces intercommunicating lined by flat endothelium, and they are surrounded by collagen and elastic fibers as well as smooth muscles. Also, the same here in the corpus spongiosum, where we have the penile urethra in the center, and the cavernous spaces also are present, and in between we have a lot of elastic fibers compared to that in the corpora cavernosa. So the elastic fibers in between here are more than that, while the tunica albuginea here is thicker than the tunica albuginea in the corpus spongiosum. This is the section of the penis, two corpora cavernosa and the corpus spongiosum, and this is the penile urethra, and this is the tunica albuginea, very well developed here and less developed in the corpus spongiosum. And this is the skin, epidermis, here the epidermis and the dermis. And don't forget that it is devoid of subcutaneous fat to allow free movement of the skin during intercourse. Again, this is the section in the penis to corpora cavernosa and the corpus spongiosum, the penile urethra, the tunica albuginea, the epidermis, the dermis, no subcutaneous fat. Number one, identify the organ, testis. Number two, identify the entire structure indicated by the arrow, seminiferous tubule. Number three, identify the cell type indicated by the arrow, interstitial cells of Leydig. Number four, what do these cells produce? Testosterone. Identify the organ, testis. Identify the cell type indicated by the arrow. Here it is the primary spermatocyte. Why? Because it is the largest cell with the largest nucleus, showing different stages of coiling of the chromosomes. Number three, identify the cell type indicated by the arrow. In 15, it is the spermatid. Why? Because it is a rounded cell with a rounded nucleus, smaller in size, of course, than the spermatocyte. Number four, identify the cell type indicated by the arrow. These are the interstitial cells of Leydig. Identify the organ. This organ shows a sinai which have characteristic folding. This is the prostate. Number 38, identify the entire structure indicated by the arrow. 38, it is the prostatic acinus. Number 39, identify the tissue indicated by the arrow. This is the fibro. Muscular tissue present in between the acini or the lobules. Fibromuscular tissue containing smooth muscle. Number four, identify the structure indicated by the arrow. These are the prostatic concretions or corpora amylicea. Number one, identify the organ, penis. Number two, identify the structure indicated by the arrow, corpus cavernosum. Number three, identify the structure indicated by the arrow. This is, of course, a medial septum formed of connective tissue. This is a medial septum separating the two corpora cavernosa formed of the connective tissue. Number four, identify the structure. This is the penile urethra. If you are asked what is the lining of this penile urethra, it is, of course, the stratified columnar epithelium, which changes to stratified squamous in its distal part, which is called fossa navicularis. Identify the organ, the testis. Identify the entire structure indicated by the arrow, seminiferous tubule. Identify the cell type indicated by the arrow, interstitial cells of Leydig. Number four, identify the structures indicated by the arrow, spermatozoa or sperms. Identify the organ. Here the organ is formed of these sections, and it has a lumen, and it is lined by pseudostratified columnar ciliated. These cilia are stereocilia containing sperms inside. So this is the epididymis. Number two, identify the layer indicated by the arrow. What is the arrow? 30. This area is adventitia outside the epididymis tubule. Number 31, identify the cell type. They are the spermatozoa or the sperms. Number 4, identify the structure indicated by the arrow. These are the stereocilia. What is the function of these stereocilia? This is increasing of the surface area for the exchange between the cell and the contents of the lumen. And these cells is responsible for the secretion and absorption. Identify the organ. This is the prostate. Why? Because it has a sinai with characteristic folding inside and separated by fibromuscular tissue. Identify the tissue indicated by the arrow. It is the fibromuscular septa. Number three, identify the structure indicated by the arrow. It is here prostatic concretion. Number four, where in the body is this organ located? It is present at the base of the urinary bladder, wrapping the upper part of the male urethra. Identify the entire structure. Here it is the seminiferous tubule. Identify the cell type indicated by the arrow. The arrow 18. Here, the arrow 18. Yes, these are the spermatogonia. Why? Because they are rounded cells with ovoid or rounded dark nuclei resting on the basement membrane. And then number 19. Here, identify the cell. Here, this nucleus is triangular with clear appearance and prominent nucleolus and no evident cell boundary. So this is the nucleus of the Sertoli cell. Number 3. Here, identify the cell type indicated by the arrow. These are the spermatid, which is an oval small cell before forming the sperm by spermiogenesis. Identify the organ epididymis. Identify the tissue indicated by the arrow. Here, this is epithelium, which is pseudocertified columnar ciliated with non-motile cilia or stereocilia. Number 3, identify the tissue indicated by the arrow. Here, this is a connective, this is the muscle tissue surrounding the epididymis tubule. This is the muscle tissue, and behind it we have, this is the muscle tissue, and this is the connective tissue, adventitious. So this is the muscle immediately surrounding the mucosa of this tubule, and this is the adventitious. Number 12, identify the cell type indicated by the arrow. Here we have the sperms. Identify the organ. This organ is a hollow organ, and the epithelium here is pseudostratified columnar epithelium here. This is the vas deferens due to the huge muscle layer surrounding this epithelium or mucosa. Identify the tissue indicated by the arrow in 22. It is the muscle tissue, musculosa layer. Number three, identify the tissue indicated by the organ, by the arrow. This is the pseudocertified columnar ciliated with non-motile cilia. Of course, this is in the lower part. And after that, they lose the cilia. But here we have some appearance of these cilia, so it is pseudocertified columnar ciliated with stereocilia. Number 24, identify the cell type. These are the sperms. Identify the organ. This is the testis. Identify the cell type indicated by the arrow 38. These are large cells with large nuclei, coiling of chromosomes. This is a primary spermatocyte. What is the number of chromosomes? It is a diploid number. Number 39, identify the cell type. Here, 39, yes. 39, here I am seeing a triangular nucleus, pale with prominent nucleolus, no boundaries. This is the Sertoli cell. Number 40, identify the cell type indicated by the arrow. Yes, this is the spermatogonium. Lale, and he a rounded cell with a dark rounded or ovoid nucleus.